أنا الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، يقول الإمام الذهبي رحمه الله تعالى: الكبيرة الثانية عشرة الزنا، وبعضه أكبر إثم من بعض. الإمام الذهبي، may Allah عز وجل have mercy upon him and upon his Shaykh, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, and his brothers, al-Imam Abdullah ibn Abdul Hadi, al-Imam al-Muzzi, وغيرهم وعلينا كذلك. He said, the next kabira is the kabira of az-zina. And some zina is greater than other forms of zina. So the zina has darajat and anwa. And from the categories or different types of zina is the zina of al-muta'a. The muta'a that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about it: يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنِّي قَدْ كُنْتُ أَذَنْتُ لَكُمْ فِي اسْتِمْنَاءِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى قَدْ حَرَّمَ ذَلِكَ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. O you people, I allowed you at one time to practice al-muta'a with the women, but verily Allah has made that haram until يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. So there was a time when al-muta'a marriage was permissible, and then he made it haram in the year that they conquered the Yahud of Khaybar. And some of the companions narrated that it was in the year of Fath Mecca. And from the narrators of this hadith is Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. So any revert Muslim or any Muslim who comes into the deen, do not be fooled by the authentic statement that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu was of the opinion that muta'a was permissible. That is authentic. But what's also authentic is that when he found out that it was made haram and the companions told him about it, he left it and he dropped it. So I find it strange, ikhwani fillahi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned concerning his companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ. Allah described them as being the truthful ones. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Allah said about them, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Allah is pleased with them and they're pleased with Allah. هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. He, Allah, is the one who sent to the unlettered people a Nabi from their own selves, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He purified them, he taught them the book, and he taught them the hikmah. So Allah has established in the Quran that the tazkiyah has come to the companions, and they were the ulama of the Quran and the ulama of the sunnah. And then a group of people come today who say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's companions were kuffar. And they say that muta'a marriage is halal. And they say that the Quran is incomplete. And they say part of their religion is a tuqya, to lie. So they are liars. They have no adala. They have no diana. And they make zina, and they have children of zina because they practice muta'a marriage. So Allah has established in the Quran that muta'a marriage was acceptable at one time, but it has been abrogated until Yawm al-Qiyamah. And from the zina that people from Ahl al-Sunnah fall into is the zina of the man who divorces his wife 3 times, and some people 10 times, some people 20, some people 100. Some people say to their wives, you're divorced 1,000,000 times. And they remain living with the wife. All of the children that come after that third divorce is zina. At-talaqu marratayn fa imsakum bima'ruf aw tasrihum bi ihsan. O you men, you are allowed to divorce your wives two times. After divorcing her the second time, either retain them in kindness with what is reasonable, or let them go with honor. And then Allah Ta'ala mentioned after that some ayahs later on in the surah. فَإِن تَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُم مِّن بَعْدٍ حَتَّى تَنْكِهَا زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ فَإِن تَلَّقَهَا فَلَا جُنَاهَا عَلَيْهِمَا أَن يَتَرَاجَعَا إِنْ ظَنَّا أَن يُقِيمَا حُدُودَ اللَّهِ. So if the man divorces his wife the third time, she is not halal for him until she marries a new man. And if that new man divorces her, and the sunnah said has relations with her, and then he divorces her, then it's no problem for the first husband to remarry her again if the man and the woman thought that they can keep the limits that have been ordained by Allah. Anyone who is sitting in our masjid, anyone who you know, divorced his wife more than three times out of embarrassment, he didn't take witnesses, and the wife is still with him, that is zina. And those kids that come after that third divorce are abna'u zina. From the zina that people fall into is the zina of the nikah of a tahleel and the nikah of a shighar. The man divorces his wife three times and he has some level of taqwa. He knows she has to get married to someone else. So he does what the Prophet calls sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-tais al-musta'ab. He borrows a bull. He borrows a stud. And he says, come, I divorce my wife the third time. You marry her and make a halal for me, and then I'll marry after you divorce her. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la'ana Allah al-muhallil wal-muhallal lahu. Allah has cursed the stud and the one who asked him to do it. Zina. From the zina that the people fall into is the nikah of shighar. A man wants to marry another man's daughter or sister, and he has a daughter or a sister. So he says, I marry you to my daughter with no dowry. You marry me to your daughter with no dowry. That zina is not permissible in that nikah, is batil. So a zina, ikhwani, it has levels. From what we just mentioned, all of that is from the kaba'ir, and people have fallen into it. But even greater than that is the zina of as-sihaq wal-liwaq, the zina of homosexuality and the zina of lesbianism. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Uqtulu wal-fa'il wal-maf'ul bihi." Kill the one who does it and the one who is being done to. اقتلوا الأعلى والأسفل. Kill the one who was on top and the one who was on the bottom, whether it's a man or a woman. And this is going to come, inshallah, in Kitab al-Kaba'ir. Al-Liwat, homosexuality, and how the companions looked at it, and how they used to punish them, and the severity and the seriousness of it. It's from the worst types of zina. And from the worst types of zina is the zina of having relations with animals. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من وجدتموه وقع على بهيمة فاقتلوه واقتلوا البهيمة. قيل لي عبد الله بن عباس, يا عبد الله بن عباس, ما شأن البهيمة, يعني ما ذنب البهيمة حتى تقتل. قال رضي الله عنه, لم أسمع من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في ذلك الشيء, ولكني أعتقد أنه ما أراد أن ينتفع منه. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas, if you find someone having relationships with an animal, kill the one who was doing it and kill the animal. They asked Abdullah ibn Abbas, what's the fault of the animal? What did the animal do? He said, I didn't hear Rasulullah say anything about why the animal was killed. But I believe the reason why he said it is, he didn't want that animal to be benefited from. You can't eat his meat, you can't sell him, can't do anything with that animal. Once someone did something with the animal does not deserve the right to walk on the face of the earth. I saw with my own eyes a program of a non-Muslim bragging about him being married to a donkey. And he kissed a donkey. And he bragged about the other things that he does with the donkey. And here comes the Muslim man and woman embarrassed about the opinions of those people. The azwaj of the himar and kilab. Our women become embarrassed about wearing hijab from the opinions of those people. Zina. So with zina, ikhwan, it has anwa darajat. From the worst type of zina is the zina that a man makes with his relative. The zina that a man makes with his relative. He does molestation to his stepdaughter. He molests his own daughter. He has relations with his brother's wife. Abdullah ibn Abbas and Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. He said that the Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لِيَنْ يَزْنِيَ الرَّجُلُ بِعَشْرَةِ نِسْوَةٍ أَيْسَرُ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ يَزْنِي بِمْرَأَةِ جَارِهِ. For a man to commit fornication with 10 women is better, lighter for him, less in degree than for him to commit fornication with a woman of his neighbor. She's not even related to him, but because of the qurb, that's the neighbor, the jar and the jara. What about the qariba, the aqarib, the people who are close to him in his blood, his daughter, his wife's daughter? So from the qiyas al-awla, if it is 10 women for the neighbor, then what do you think is the situation for the person who has zina with a relative? And that's going to come. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent a companion to kill the man who married his wife, his father's wife. So a zina, ikhwani, has levels. The one who was married and he commits zina, he is stoned to death. The one who was married, not married, and he commits zina, he is flogged 100 times, and he is put out and expelled from the city for a year. That comes from the sunnah. So those people come today and they say, we are the Qur'aniyun. We don't believe in a rajab. We don't believe in stoning, because that's not in the Qur'an. Wallahi, they're liars, because the ayat of stoning was in the book of Allah. And Allah took it out. He abrogated. There are different ways that the Quran and the Sunnah abrogate. Sometimes the ayat remains, but the hukum is not there. Sometimes the ayat is gone, and the hukum remains. The ruling, like in the case of stoning. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stoned 6 people. 6 people doing his time. So the Muslim says it's not in the Quran. مَا نَنْسَخْ مِنْ آيَةٍ أَنُنْسِهَا نَاتِ بِخَيْرٍ مِنْهَا وَمِثْلِهَا أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا لَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مِنْ وَلِيٍّ وَلَا نَصِيرٍ أَمْ تُرِيدُونَ أَنْ تَسْأَلُوا رَسُولَكُمْ كَمَا سُئِلَ مُوسَى مِنْ قَبْلُ وَمَنْ يَتَبَدَّلِ الْإِيمَانَ بِالْكُفْرِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ سَوَاءَ السَّبِيلِ. Allah doesn't cause an ayah to be abrogated or forgotten, except that he replaces it with an ayah that is better than it or what is similar to it. Don't you know, Muhammad, that Allah can do whatever he wants to do? Don't you know it belongs to Allah what is in the heavens and the earth? And you have no wali and no nasir other than Allah? Or do you people want to question your Nabi as Musa was questioned before? What color cow? How big is the cow? What portion should the cow live in? What? So that ayat was in the Quran and it was abrogated. And I say right now that the ayat of al-rajm is still in the Quran. It is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا أَتَاكُمْ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ أَنْ فَانْتَهُوا. What the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered you people to do, take it. What he prohibited you from, leave it. So that shows that the aqiqah is in the Quran. The ahkam of al-aqiqah in the Quran. The curse that he put upon the washima and the mustoshima and the wasila wal mustosila, all of that is in the Quran by that ayah. So with zina, different levels, ikhwani. One person is stoned to death, the other person is expelled from the city, and he is flogged 100 times. Another point concerning zina that is a critical point is that the vast majority of us sitting in this masjid have fallen into zina. I'm not calling you brothers and sisters zunat, especially the women. But most people are falling into zina. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, in Sahih al-Bukhari, a Muslim, he said that the Rasul said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ عَلِ ابْنِ آدَمْ حَظُّهُ مِنَ الزِّنَا مُدْرِكُ ذَلِكَ لَا مَحَالَ فَزِنَ الْعَيْنَيْنِ النَّظَرْ وَزِنَ اللِّسَانَ النُّطْقِ وَالنَّفْسُ تَمَنَّ وَتَشْتَهِي وَالنَّفْسُ تَمَنَّ ذَلِكَ وَتَشْتَهِي وَيُصَدِّقُ ذَلِكَ الْفَرْجُ أَوْ يُكَذِّبُهُ. Allah has written on the sons of Adam their portion of zina. They're going to fall into it and they can't help it. It's going to happen. The zina of the eyes is looking at what's haram. The zina of the tongue is mentioning those things that are haram. And the nafs desires it. It wants it and it desires it. And the private parts either make it a reality or protects them from it. You go outside of our masjid on Green Lane, you make a right on the corner of Green Lane and Coventry Road. The non-Muslims put up there a big poster giving dawah to lesbianism. Only a few meters away from our masjid. And I have to say this, I was in Luton recently, and the brothers from Hizb ut-Tahrir, who I don't agree with their understanding of Islam and their way of establishing the Khilafah. But al-Haq yuqal, in Luton, those brothers from Hizb ut-Tahrir, they go around late at night, they get a ladder, they get up on top of the billboards, and they paint the naked ladies all black until all you see is her eyes, and it's like she has a jilbab on. Wallahi, ni'ma ma fa'alu. When you see like the picture of the lady laying down on the water, when I first came upon it, I thought it was an adverb for a woman in jilbab, black jilbab, niqab, everything. Then I realized that's that famous poster of the lady laying on the water with the rocks on her back. So some of the brothers took from that sunnah and did the same thing here, but without the artistry of the Luton people. Did the Muslims do that? Allahu alam, Allahu alam. And I'm not encouraging people to do that. But that's their freedom of speech. Muslims, we should make a point about issues like this. Those kuffar should hear our opinion about issues like this. We should have enough organization, enough leadership to let those people know this is not tolerated in our community. Why by the masjid? They don't do it by the church. So we expect from the Muslim leadership to have a stance and to make positions. Let those people know. And if not, those people who do things like that, we say, if'alu wala haraj. Az-zina, different levels and different degrees and different types. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullahu ta'ala, brought four ayat of the Quran and a number of ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concerning az-zina. The first ayat is the statement of Allah Ta'ala, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنُّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. Do not come close to az-zina. It didn't say don't fall into zina. The ayat said, do not come close to az-zina, for verily it is fahisha, and a terrible way to go, a terrible way. This ayat of the Quran, ikhwan, has given the ulama of al-Islam and the Muslims a concept that we use in all aspects of our lives. And it is what is called sadd al-dhari'. Sadd al-dhari'ah is closing the door of something before it happens. The best way to cure a sickness is preventing it. Al-wiqaya is the best ilaj for anything. You don't want to get cancer, don't smoke cigarettes. You don't want to become a drunk, don't drink khamr. You want to have religious children, don't let them watch TV unsupervised. Close the door. That's what this ayah is saying. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا. It didn't say don't fall into it, don't come close to it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated a number of ways to prevent people from coming close to a zina. Like the statement of the Quran, قُلْ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغَضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا يَصْنَعُونَ وَقُلْ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا. Tell the believing men, lower your gazes and protect your privates. That is better for you, and Allah is well aware of what you do. And tell the believing women, lower your gazes and protect your privates, and do not expose your zina, your beauty, except what must ordinarily appear, her face and her hands, to the majority of the scholars. Some of them say, just one eye. So that's one of the ways that Allah has legislated, don't come close to a zina. How do we not come close to zina? إِيَّاكُمْ وَالدُّخُولْ عَلَى النِّسَى. Beware of entering in upon the women and freely mixing with them, as it is a part of our culture. Beware, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالدُّخُولْ عَلَى النِّسَى. If you don't sit there together, the brother-in-law will not fall in love with the sister-in-law. From the ways, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَا يَخْلُو رَجُلٌ بِمْرَأَةٍ إِلَّا كَانِ الشَّيْطَانِ ثَارِثُهُمَا. A man is never alone with a woman, except that a shaitan is the third of them. Don't be alone with the woman. Anas ibn Malik said, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْ نَهَى النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ أَنْ تُكُلِّمَ النِّسَاءَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ أَزْوَاجِهِنْ. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited us from talking to women except with the permission of their husbands. No man has the right to talk to another man's wife except with his knowledge and permission. To talk with his daughter except with his knowledge or his permission. His sister except with his knowledge or permission. Except what is necessary. She's the one who's going to serve you at the library. You have to talk to her. But we're talking about just sitting down, having conversations about marriage and what you like and what you don't like. What colors do you like? What's your favorite food? What's your favorite ice cream? That's haram. No one can marry a girl except that her wali knows about it. So all of those are ways in which Al-Islam said, don't come close to a zina, and there are so many. The next ayat that Imam Al-Dhahabi brings is the statement of Allah Ta'ala showing and proving a zina is a kabira from the kabair. وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَٰهٍ آخر وَلَا يَقْتُرُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَى أَثَامًا. And those people who do not make shirk with Allah, and they do not kill people who do not deserve to be killed, and they do not make zina, anyone who does that, they will receive their punishment. They will get their ithm for what they did. So that proves that zina is a major sin, because Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned that zina along with a shirk, murder, and then zina. And that's the order that the majority of the scholars say the biggest of the kaba'ir are in that order. A shirk, and then murder, and then the greatest kabira after murder is a zina. And zina is different levels and different degrees. The man came and asked him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, ayul kabira akbar wa a'zam indallah. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an taj'al lillahi niddan wa huwa khalaqaka. Qala thumma ay, qala an taqtul walade خشية أن يطعم معك. قال ثم أي؟ قال أن تزاني حليل جارك. يا رسول الله, what's the worst kabira from the kabair? That you make with Allah another partner, and Allah created you. And then after that, that you kill your child out of fear that the child will eat with you and share your food, thinking that you're going to be poor. So from zina comes the baby. When the unwanted child comes, there's an abortion. He fell into murder and zina. to make shirk with Allah, to kill your child or anyone else. Number three, which one, Ya Rasulullah? That you commit zina with your neighbor's wife. All from the kaba'ir. He brought the third hadith or ayat, or the fourth ayat, the statement of Allah Ta'ala, الزَّانِيَةُ وَالزَّانِي فَاجْلِدُوا كُلَّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا مِئَةَ جَلْدًا وَلَا تَأْخُذْكُمْ بِهِمَا رَأْفَةٌ فِي الدِّينِ اللَّهِ. The fornicating woman and the fornicating man, flogged both of them 100 times for what they did. Flog both of them 100 times. And do not allow any mercy to cause you to refrain from flogging them in the religion of Allah. Stand up for the truth and establish the religion. Flog them. There's a very important point that we have to mention at this particular juncture. And we want every Muslim sister to open up her ears and to open up her eyes and her intellect and pay attention to this latifa from the Quran, the hikmah of the book of Allah, according to what the ulama of Islam understood. If you look at the Quran, brothers and sisters, and gather many of the ayat, the majority of the ayat that mention men and women, whether they're believers or non-believers, Allah almost always in the Quran mentions the men and He mentions the women over and over. إن المؤمنين والمؤمنات إن المسلمين والمسلمات الرجال للرجال نصيب مما ترك الوالدان والأقربون وللنساء نصيب مما ترك الوالدان والأقربون للرجال نصيب مما اكتسبوا وللنساء نصيب مما اكتسبنا. So many ayat of the Quran, even with the kuffar, ليعذب الله المنافقين والمنافقات والمشركين والمشركات وَيَتُوبُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. So many ayahs of the Quran. لَوْلَا إِذْ سَمِعْتَمُوهُ ظَنَّ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ بِأَنفُسِهِمْ خَيْرًا. When you heard it, when you heard the slander on Aisha, the believing men and the believing women should have thought about themselves good. But in this ayah, Allah mentioned the woman first. الزَّانِيَةُ وَالزَّانِي. The woman who fornicates and the man who fornicates, flog both of them 100 times. The scholar said, one of the wisdoms behind that, Ikhwani, is because ultimately, the responsibility of the zina falls on the shoulders of the girl, because she's the one who's going to ultimately give the final word, except for the one who rapes the woman. Another terrible form of a zina is to rape someone. لا يسرق السارق حين يسرق وهو مؤمن. The one who steals something, when he steals it, he's not a believer. His iman leaves him. لعن الله من يسرق البيضة فتقطع يده. May the curse of Allah be upon the one who steals an egg, so his hand is chopped off for stealing an egg. He did it multiple times. He's a pathological thief. So what about the one who steals that which is one of the most honorable things to the woman, and he rapes her? So the ulama of Islam said, Allah mentioned the woman here as zaniya first, because ultimately the responsibility of a zina lies with the woman. So the Muslim woman has to be careful. All he's doing is trying to chat you up, and he's promising you so many things. He's not going to marry you. If he was going to marry you, he would have married you and gone about it the correct way. Promise you, all kind of promises. Yeah, and when we get married, after we do it, I'm going to take you to Saudi Arabia, and you're going to study in Umm al-Qura, and I'm going to be over there, and we're going to work, and you're going to memorize the Quran. Every year I'm going to take you to your mother's house. Every year. And he's lying. So it's ultimately up to the girl. And for that reason, when some of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they argued amongst themselves as to who would take custody of a child that was born from zina. Each one of them were making a claim, but the child was a child from zina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about that child, الولد للفراش والآهر الحجر The baby belongs to the bed in which it was born on, to the mother. And the one who made the zina with her gets the rocks. Means you go away with nothing. You don't take the boy's name. He doesn't take your name. He's not from your loins. Our children are established through nikah. The child is established, and our lineage is established in Islam through the proper nikah. So we have to be diligent in marrying people the correct way. We have to be correct and serious in not having children, knowingly or unknowingly, and by the means and the ways that are not from Al-Islam. So that lady is responsible for that child. And the child becomes known as Abdullah ibn Fatima, Ahmed ibn Maryam, because the father is not known. So ibn Zina. The last ayah is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الزاني لا ينكح إلا زانية أو مشركة وزانية لا ينكحها إلا زان أو مشرك وحرم ذلك على المؤمنين. Pay attention to this misunderstood ayah so that we inshallah ta'ala can open up the door of rahmah and some of our brothers or sisters who want to get married to good people. The ayah said that the man who was guilty of committing zina, he doesn't marry anyone except another woman who was guilty of zina or a mushrik. And the believing woman who was guilty of committing zina in her life, she doesn't marry anyone except another man who was guilty of zina or a mushrik. And that is haram on the believers. This ayah of the Quran is misunderstood. Some people understood that the ayah is saying that if a person committed zina, they can only marry a person also guilty of committing zina or marry a mushrik. And this is not the case. The revert who committed zina has children in jahiliyyah, from the men or the women, when they come into Islam, it's permissible for them to marry the virgins from our community. The ayat is not what the scholars call the insha'ul hukum. It is not a ruling telling you if you committed zina, you only can marry a zaniya or a mushrika. It's haram to marry mushrik women. وَلَا تَنْكِهُ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنَّ وَلَا أَمَةُ مُؤْمِنَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِنْ مُشْرِكَةٍ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ. Don't marry the disbelieving women, a mushrik woman, until they believe. And the slave woman who's a believer is better than the mushrik women, even though the mushrik women may please you. Men can't marry mushrik women, and definitely Muslim women can't marry them as well. So the ayat is saying, if a man wants to get married, or a woman wants to get married, it is not permissible to marry someone who is committing zina right now, or someone who was a zani or a zaniya and they didn't make tawbah from the zina that they committed. But if they make tawbah, al-Islam yujubbu ma kana qablu. Islam wipes away what went before it. This ayat, as the scholars of the tafsir of the Quran say, there's a science in the Quran called asbabun nuzul, the reason why the ayats were revealed. The scholars of Islam wrote books like that. Al-Imam al-Waqidi, a Sheikh Muqbil, wrote one with only what is authentic. When a person knows why the ayat was revealed, he'll understand correctly the meaning of the ayat. So the Quran was revealed upon the companions. So how was it possible someone's going to come today and say that the companions were kuffar? Ala kulli hal, there was a companion by the name of Marthad ibn Abi Marthad al-Ghanawi radiyallahu anhu. His job was, he used to leave al-Medina and go to Mecca and bring back the captives, to bring them back to Medina to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because that's money. Bring back the captives. So we have to sneak inside of Mecca and get the slaves and the people he was going to bring back, and then get back to al-Medina. On one of his trips, he was in Medina, and he was spotted by a woman by the name of Anaq, mushrik woman from Mecca. It was his girlfriend in Jahiliyyah that he used to have illicit relationships with. When she noticed him after not seeing him for a long time because he made hijrah, she said, Marathan, marhaban bik, ta'al, wabit indi. Come, ya Marathan, come and sleep with me tonight. Stay in my home tonight. Marathan said, radiyallahu anhu, inna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qad harrama dhalika. Rasulullah made that haram. Naha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an mahr al-baghi. Rasulullah made it haram, the price that you get, the money that you get from prostitution. Don't give it in sadaqah. Don't use it for anything. It's not permissible. Allah's Rasul made it haram. The lady got mad. So she called the people of Mecca and said, here is Marthan. He's here to take the slaves. Get him. The scorn of a woman. So they went chasing after Marthan. He ran into the mountains of Mecca. He said, radiallahu anhu, I hid between some rocks in a little crevice. The eight of them came, and when they didn't find me, they decided to urinate all together, and they urinated on me. And he was patient, fi sabilillah. He was patient for Allah and his messenger. He had a job. He has to get back to Mecca, to Medina. He went back to Medina, told Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam the story. Rasulullah remained silent. He didn't know what was the ruling. Ya Rasulullah, I saw Anaq. This is what happened. She was my girlfriend in Jahiliyyah. I want to marry her. Can I marry her? He was quiet. And then Allah Azza wa Jal, after some time, revealed this particular ayah. The one who is a fornicator only marries another woman who's a fornicator, who doesn't see that as being haram or being a big issue, or marries a mushrik because they don't see it as being big. And the lady who's a fornicator will only marry another man who's guilty of it because he doesn't see it as, she doesn't see it as being big. Or she marries a mushrik because they don't see it as being haram. وَحُرِّمَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. So it is not permissible for a believing man to marry a woman who's a zaniya. That's the reason why this particular ayat of the Quran was revealed. So those are the ayat that Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi brought in this particular chapter. Concerning the issue of marrying the woman who is guilty of committing zina, or the woman marrying a man who was guilty of committing zina, this is permissible if they made tawbah. This is permissible. Al-Islam, a tawbah wipes away what went before it. In addition to that, Allah Ta'ala has mentioned to the men in the Quran and the women in so many ayat and a number of ayat about the permissibility of marrying women, like the statement of Allah in the Quran, فَنْكِهُهُنَّ بِإِذْنِ أَهْلِهِنَّ وَآتُوهُنَّ أَجُورُهُنَّ مُحْسَنَاتِ غَيْرُ مُسَافِحَاتِ وَلَا مُتَّخِذَاتِ أَخْدَانِ. You men, if you want to marry the women, marry them after you've gotten the permission from their fathers, from their awliya, and pay them their dowries. And marry the women who are chas, muhsanat, غَيْرُ مُسَافِحَاتِ, not the ones who make zina, وَلَا مُتَّخِذَاتْ أَخْدَانِ, and not the women who have boyfriends. That's what he said to the men, and he described the women who we marry. He said to the men, or to the women about marrying men who are like that, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَالْمُحْسَنَاتُ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْمُحْسَنَاتُ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ إِذَا آتَيْتُمُهُنَّ أُجُورُهُنْ مُحْسِنِينَ غَيْرُ مُسَافِهِينَ وَلَا مُتَّخِذِ أَخْدَانِ. And permissible for you men to marry are the virtuous, righteous, believing women and the virtuous, righteous women from Ahlul Kitab who were given the book before you. Marry them and give them their dowries. And you men, be upright, don't commit zina, and don't have girlfriends. So we can marry women from Ahlul Kitab, but if the lady is a zaniya, practicing zina now, it's haram. If the Ahlul Kitab lady is having other relationships, haram. حُرِّمَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It's not permissible.
as it relates to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-Imam al-Dhahibi rahimahullahu ta'ala, he brought these few hadith. We'll read the next two and we'll stop here. بإذن الله تعالى قال الإمام الذهبي وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام لا يزني الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن ولا يسرق سارق حين يسرق وهو مؤمن ولا يشرب الخمر حين يشربها وهو مؤمن. A man does not commit zina while he's doing it and he remains a believer. Nor does he drink khamr, smoke crack, do narcotics while he's doing it, except that he's not a believer. And a man does not, he doesn't commit zina, he doesn't make zina, drink khamr, nor does he steal while he is a mu'min. The second hadith is similar to that. إذا زنى العبد خرج منه الإيمان فكان كالظلة فإذا انقلع منها رجع إليه الإيمان. If a slave commits zina, iman comes off of him and out of him. And if he goes back, when he leaves the zina, that's when his iman comes back to him. من زنى أو شرب الخمر نزع الله منه الإيمان كما يخلو الإنسان القميص من رأسه. This is not an authentic hadith. Whoever makes zina or drinks khamr, Allah Ta'ala takes away from him the iman, the way he takes off of the thawb from himself. These three hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are hadith that are misunderstood by the khawarij and the people who make takfir. The people who want to make takfir of people, they love making takfir of the Muslims. The hadith said, the person, when he commits zina, he's not a mu'min. When he drinks khamr, he's not a mu'min. When he steals, he's not a mu'min. So they must be kuffar. That's the position of the Mu'tazila. That's the position of the Khawarij. But the position, ikhwani, of Ahl-Sunnah, Ahl-Hadith, is that anyone who commits any of these sins, while he's doing it, he's not a mu'min, kamilul iman. His iman is not complete. And iman goes up when you obey Allah, and your iman goes down when you disobey Allah. The bigger the crime, the bigger the dhunub and the ma'asi, the more your iman will go down. But you will always have iman. And whether you make tawbah or not from the sin that you committed, you're under the mashi'ah of Allah. If He wants, He'll forgive you. If He doesn't want, He won't forgive you. You don't go outside of the religion of Al-Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we mentioned, the lady Al-Ghamadiyya radiyallahu anha committed zina and was stoned to death. And the companion said some things. He said, don't help the shaitan over her. If you put her iman on the scale, the iman of people in Medina on the other scale, her iman from the Toba will be better and more than theirs. And he prayed over her. And he prayed over the Ma'iz man. If they were kuffar, would he pray the Salat of al-Janazah over them? He didn't pray the Salat of al-Janazah over the one who had a debt. And he prayed over the one who had the hajj from the hudud of Allah established. He wouldn't pray the janazah over a non-Muslim. So those ahadith are talking about the completion of a person's iman. We're going to stop here, inshallah ta'ala, because it's a relatively long bab. And we ask Allah ta'ala to protect our eyes, our tongues, our hearts, our mind, our children, our women, ourselves from az-zina in all of its shapes, form, fashions. And we ask Allah ta'ala to take us out of the environment that is not conducive to a man or a woman having al-izza and sharaf. Prevents a woman from being aziza and sharifa. And that al-hayat, she can't have hayat because in order to survive, she has to be aggressive and she has to live despite herself. And that's why for most of us, al-hijrah from these environments are an obligation. Az-zina is a kabira from the kabair. From az-zina, ikhwani, is the man who marries a woman and he runs off with her without getting the permission of her parents. That's zina. You have to have the wali. There has to be a wali in the nikah. La nikah illa bi wali. If the person is Hanafi and he really believes with ikhlas and sincerity that the Hanafi way is correct in that, then that is not zina. He made a mistake. when they came to Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and Abu Huraira in another incident, the man said, I committed zina with this woman and I want to marry her. Abu Huraira said, marry her and be quiet about the zina. The people were sitting there, they said, how could you allow him to marry her? He said, radiallahu anhu, kana awwal amrihim as-sifah wa akhir amrihim an-nikah. Their beginning was zina and their end was marriage. So if a person makes a mistake and he wants to rectify it, don't go broadcasting. You'll make a fitna for yourself. Those people who know that you can't marry a woman without a wali, if you marry her and elope and you consummate, you have committed zina in the religion of Al-Islam. And that child is Ibnu Zina, Bintu Zina. So let us protect our privacy, as the ayat of the Quran said, wahfudhu. Let them protect their privacy. When you protect it, you protect your lineage.